Okay, Neil, on March 11th, coming up, 2016, in case you're watching this as an old rerun, there, Biola University has these Christian apologists. They're defenders of the faith traveling around the country, and they're coming to Eugene, which is not far from where I live in Portland area. And so we have three of them coming here, Craig Hazen, J.P. Moreland, and Clay Jones. And I'm going to set up a presentation at a nearby place before they come into town on the same day, just a couple hours before that, if people want to come to it. And I'm basically going to say how I debunk what they are saying. And they have three different, they're going to be talking about the evidence for the resurrection, why does God permit evil, and what is the evidences for God's existence. So anyway, in studying for that, I looked up what some of these people are saying and what they believe. And Dr. Craig Hazen, for example, was in a short video. It's 2 minutes long. It's called What Distinguishes Christianity from Other Faiths. And I'll play a clip of that right now.
Dr. Hazen, we're living in a time where a lot of people are confused about Christianity or other faiths for that matter. I mean, they'll say, what distinguishes Christianity from other faiths? When you look at other faiths, they'll claim miracles, they'll claim healings, they'll believe that God leads them by providence, they'll say that God answers their prayers, they have special revelation. So how do we really feel confident as Christians that we've got the right truth?
You know, we actually use the mind that God has given us to explore these claims. And it's not that hard. In fact, one thing I've discovered is people of other faiths, and even religious studies experts and experts in world religions, hate the idea of actually probing those claims. You see? In other words, if a Buddhist makes a claim, or a Hindu or a Muslim makes a claim, you know, or a Mormon, for goodness sakes, don't probe the claim. Right? Don't investigate it, because you'll be disappointed, or it's not going to give you the answer you're hoping for, or it really can't be probed because it's so mystical and otherworldly. Christianity is very different in that it invites investigation. It says, come and explore this and see if you can understand. And again, Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 makes this outrageous statement. If Jesus did not come back from the dead, Christianity is just not true. Your faith is worthless. Go do something else, for goodness sake. There's no other religion that takes the probing and the investigation so seriously. Christianity can withstand that kind of investigation. Other religions just simply can't.
Okay, so as I summarize that clip, basically the question that was given to him was, what distinguishes Christianity from all the other faiths? And he even mentioned that, you know, a lot of the faiths claim divine revelation and they have miracle healings and stuff like that. So from what I saw, Craig's answer was, number one, that Christians use the mind. And he said that other faiths hate the idea of probing claims. But he said basically Christianity can withstand the investigation. That's what he left on his message. That's how he left the message. Basically, that was a summarization that Christianity does invite investigation, and it can take the investigation. It can withstand it. And then he also brought up that if Jesus didn't rise, then Christianity is all worthless, as if that was, I'm not sure what that had to do with his point. So basically, I wanted to bring up one thing here. He basically said all the other faiths hate to be probed. They hate to be questioned. One thing, I'll just do a quote here from the Dalai Lama, for example, which I think rebukes this idea. The Dalai Lama, who's a Tibetan Buddhism representative, he said, quote, if scientific analysis were conclusively to demonstrate certain claims in Buddhism to be false, then we must accept the findings of science and abandon those claims. So that's a very pro-scientific stance, I think, which I think is admirable. He's basically saying, if we believe anything that goes against science, go with the science. We'll change our beliefs. You're not going to find us contradicting science. Whereas, for example, your faith, Neil, you personally, you reject modern science as far as biological evolution. So I think the Dalai Lama here would say, yes, of course we believe in evolution, that humans evolved from other animals. What are your views on all this?
I mean, obviously, I think Craig, I think he's right in many ways. But with Buddhism, and one thing you have to understand, Buddhism is basically atheistic philosophy. I mean, Siddhartha Gautama never really said that there was a God. He just talked about reincarnation, which, by the way, is not the same reincarnation as in Hindu reincarnation. It's a slightly different modified form of it. But, I mean, if you think about it, Buddhism really isn't scientific in that sense either, because, I mean, how can you prove reincarnation? How can you prove, I mean, you don't believe in reincarnation.
Well, my understanding is that in Buddhism there's a lot of different strands. I mean, some are actually hardcore atheists where there's no afterlife, and then some of them get into worshiping God, you know, the Buddha's a God. And there's a huge range in there.
Yeah, some of them are modified Hinduism. I mean, when Buddhism got to India, it kind of, Buddha became a god, or one of the gods, right? Instead of just an enlightened being and so stuff like that. But Buddhism, basically, except for the atheistic parts of it, but the Dalai Lama himself does believe in a dharma and karma, you know, the whole idea that you will pay reap the consequences of your sins, things like that. So I would say that the Dalai Lama is a bad example for this, but there are Buddhist atheists who may be a better example. But I think when Craig was talking about it, he was talking about the traditional standard mainline religions, and I think Buddhism is not scientific in that sense. Now, Christianity is not scientific in the sense of evolution, but we believe that we can actually prove that evolution, that there is no, not sufficient evidence for macroevolution, and I hate getting into arguments about evolution, just because every time I become an expert on something, there'll be a new discovery, and then I got to go become an expert on that. So a long time ago,
you can't say Christians are against evolution, because some are very pro-evolution
theistic,
and some are against it, right?
Francis Collins is a theistic evolutionist. I believe that. I disagree with Francis Collins on that. I mean, he's a great guy, but I think that there's some theological issues with that, because Christianity does depend on the existence of a real Adam who did sin, not some sort of gradual refining of the mind and self-awareness that way. So I don't disagree with Hagen, because if you look at of Islam definitely is a very feelings-oriented religion. If you look at Hinduism, definitely very feelings-oriented religion, and there's, you know, again, reincarnation, caste system, and all that stuff. Not that the caste system really has much to do with science, but you get the point. So I think he was talking about the major religions. So I would agree with him in most cases.
But it seems like there's a lot of feelings in Christianity, too. For example, William Lane Craig, he says, you know, me personally, I feel the presence of Jesus, and that's how I know God's alive, and I'm an atheist, but when I was a Christian, I would say I felt the presence of Jesus too, but I think it's a delusion.
I would say that there are some people who go that step. I don't, you know, because I know that I may feel the presence of Jesus, but it could be the pizza I ate yesterday, you know, it could be the oxytocin flooding my system, right? There's so many other things. In fact, one of the things that I'm going to be putting in my book, the No Blind Faith book, is that you can actually sit in a lab, and they can probe your brain, put electrodes in your brain, and you will actually feel that you are in the presence of God. You will actually have this euphoric feeling that God is now communicating with you, just because of some electricity being sent through a certain part of your brain.
Well, you know what? You know what's kind of funny.
And I would say that does not mean that God really is there. So therefore, if you are going to look for that, you better look for real answers, real solid logic. And if you look at the Old Testament, whenever God did a miracle, they were not supernatural miracles that only exist in the supernatural plane, but they were supernatural miracles that had real-world physical mass, energy, and time consequences.
Well,
and that's what we're looking for.
So, you know, you're talking about this God helmet, right?
Yeah.
So this God helmet, basically, for people who don't know, the researchers put this helmet on subjects, and basically it stimulates a part of their brain and they feel like they're having an experience with God. You know, it's kind of funny because, you know, a lot of atheists probably would say, like, see, that's right there evidence that, you know, God's not real. It's just a trick on your mind. And it's kind of interesting that you are also giving it credit. You know, it's kind of funny, as an atheist and a former Christian, I kind of tend toward to be more skeptical. I mean, I would like to try it myself and see, but you know, like sometimes Christians say, hey, I feel God just like I can feel the presence of my wife, or I have a relationship with God like a relationship with my wife. That's how I kind of feel about it. And I'm skeptical that you could actually get a feeling from a helmet. And also, you know, this helmet, I think there's a story about, you know, that they put this on Richard Dawkins, and Richard Dawkins was like, well, you know, it didn't do anything for me. It's, you know, maybe, maybe I'm beyond hope, you know, because I didn't feel anything. But and then you got some atheists like Dan Barker, who used to be a fundamentalist preacher, and he goes, hey, you know, I used to speak in tongues, and I could still speak in tongues if I wanted to, but I don't believe in God, obviously. So there's a lot of funny antidotes.
Yeah, and this is why I keep reemphasizing that, you know, if we Christians are going to have faith, it better be based on facts and logic and real-world consequences, and not just feelings.
You know, it's kind of interesting because he said, you know, investigate Christianity because it can withstand the investigation. And, you know, that's not my experience at all. Like, especially if you go to a big church, if you try to talk about evolution, I agree with you. It causes a lot of problem for theology. And that's one reason why I left the faith. But a lot of churches, you know, they don't want to talk about it because it's so divisive. It's like, don't even go there and ask questions about this. Let's not argue about this. So when he says it can withstand the investigation, I kind of get a different feeling about that. I don't see them being upfront about all the issues and willing to discuss them and things like that.
Again, I think you should differentiate what the popular culture is of Christianity and what the philosophical consequence of Christianity is. I mean, I think, you know, a lot of people are seven-day creationists. Well, I'm not, right? But that doesn't mean that I think that if you, you know, that's why if you go have a debate with, you know, Ken Ham or someone, I'm going to think you'll win. But in the same way, if you go and have a debate with Hugh Roth, I think that you'll be, you know, you'll be really scrambling. So I think, you know, I think it just because there's a group of people who disagree with who think Christianity should not be investigated. Mm-hmm. Please don't take that to be what the real philosophical content of Christianity is. That's all.
Yeah, but like you said right there, like if, like on the positions there, you know, of evolution, you got the young earth creationists and you got the old earth creationists, and then you got the theistic evolutionists. And I, you know, from my experience, I went to a lot of different churches, and this is not something they were going to ever talk about in church, and they're never going to have a class on this or anything because they just say it's divisive. And I don't see how you can get deeper intellectually when they refuse to talk about these things.
Yeah, and this, and you are reflecting my frustration. In many churches, you know, it takes a lot of work to actually start teaching. Fortunately, I don't go to one of those, but I've been to churches where there it's a lot of work to get them to start focusing on apologetics, right?
Yeah.
You know, you want them to, and they don't. They're like, no, that's too low. People lose people. People will. Disengage, and you know, absolutely, and I think that is a big problem.
Well, I also see that as an atheist. I do a lot of debates, and I'm just finding in general there's very little appetite for this among anybody in the general population. Just most people, I don't know, it's just most people wouldn't be entertained, I guess. I don't know, it's just, you know, because you got to have a background to understand what's going on. I don't know, it's the only people who are really interested in this. These kind of things are a very small group of people who are really intellectually seeking. It's a very small group of people. So.
Yeah.
Anyway, well, thanks for coming on, Neil. I appreciate the chance to show people that Christians and atheists can have a friendly discussion, and thanks for being a good role model in that.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me, and I appreciate the honor.
All right. We'll talk to you later. Take care.
Sure. Yeah, bye.
Bye.